Carl, hi. Okay, so, actually the lighting is not ideal now. Oh, it's okay. So, I'm Yoram. As you can see, I study chemosensation in the medical faculty. So, short trip for me here to tell you about this system. And the system that I'm going to tell you about in these 60 minutes, I have exactly 60 minutes, so the lecture is very well timed, is the vomeronasal system. I know that at least one of you knows about the system. One of you is going to present a paper about the system. Who is it that's presenting later? So, the rest of you are not supposed to know anything about it, but he told you that you're experts on the Meynell factor system, that you know everything that needs to be known about the Meynell factor system. And this is a very schematic, simple diagram that shows the main connections to the system. So what you see here in blue are the connections of the Meynell factor system, from sensory neurons, olfactory bulb, and various regions in the rest of the brain. And the red system, the one that has very few arrows here, is the one that I'm going to tell you about. And you can see already from this image, that you cannot see in detail, that there are some parallels between the two systems, the Meynell factor system and the vomeronasal system. And just so that you know, the vomeronasal system is also known as the accessory olfactory system. So these are two names for the same system. We like vomeronasal more because it's accessory, makes it seem less important compared to the Meynell factor system. So we like to keep our own name, not to be an accessory. And there is a question, why do animals need more than one chemosensory system? We actually do not have an accessory olfactory system, vomeronasal system, but most mammals, most vertebrates actually do have the system. So mice are one example. What you can see here is, again, you see the rodent's head, and you can see the structures of the Meynell factor system, in blue in this case, and in yellow you see the structures of the vomeronasal system. And so you see that there is a vomeronasal epithelium, which I will tell you about a little bit. There is not a Meynell factor bulb, but an accessory olfactory bulb, which is a special region within the olfactory bulb that receives information from the sensory neurons of the system. And then the information is relayed not to the cortex, as it is in the Meynell factor system, but mostly to the amygdala, specific regions in the amygdala, and I will tell you a little bit about those, and then to subcortical pathways, and mainly that means the hypothalamus. So there is a parallel organization of the two systems, but there are also distinct distinctions. One of them is the regions that the two systems project. And this parallel, and so this led to, not this, but this and other pieces of information, other results, led to the idea that the Meynell factor system is a generalist system that's designed to detect a wide range of stimuli and, in response, elicit learned responses to them. And that the vomeronasal system is designed for innate responses to a smaller subset of cues. So if you want to be very simplistic, we can think of this as a pheromone system. And we'll say a few words about what we mean when we say pheromone. So this is a general idea, which is written here. That's a general idea of why we need, or why animals have two parallel systems. And this idea is also mirrors an idea that exists also in invertebrates, in insects, that show that there are also segregated pathways for learned responses to odorants, which is shown here again in blue, and some specialized regions of the system that are dedicated to controlling, for example, reproductive behaviors in insects. So this idea of parallel factory systems, a generalist one that's flexible and one that's more restricted but also dedicated, is something that's true for both invertebrates and vertebrates. So just a few words about what we mean when we say pheromones, because it's a term that's used very commonly. And if we take it very extremely, in a very popular kind of meaning, we think of some magic compound that just reaches our system and induces us to do something, usually some sexual behavior that we have no control over. That's the fictionalized popular view of a pheromone, and indeed some people exploit or try to exploit this the need that people have or the want that people have to be more attractive. And there's a pretty, it's not a big industry, but there's an industry for these compounds. If you search pheromone on the internet, you will find sites that sell products such as these, which are supposed to be based on very serious research, and which are supposed, if you wear them, they're pheromones for men and women, to be more attractive to the other sex. And the fact is, these things actually may work, but if they do so, it's probably not by some chemical, physiological pathway, more maybe by increasing the confidence of whoever is wearing them. But there is no scientific basis for believing, at least in humans, that there is something like this that can really work and make other people more attracted to us. So that kind of a pheromone, that kind of a compound that, you know, elicits some uncontrolled attraction to us does not, I would say fortunately, does not exist. But this is not to say that chemical communication is not important. It is important also in the context of reproduction, which is the context in which these are sold. And the very classic example, you know this example of the moth. So this is a silkworm moth, and it's a moth that was the first example of a characterized pheromone, meaning one molecule that elicited a very specific and stereotypical response in another organism from that same species. And what you see here a male moth, and you see this male has very elaborate antennae. And on these antennae, there are many receptors for this pheromone that was eventually purified, and a Nobel Prize was given for the identification of this pheromone. It wasn't an easy thing to do because you had to have a huge quantity of actually female, which produced, I will say it in a moment, but a huge quantity of female moth, from which this molecule, which was subsequently called bombicol, purified. And this molecule elicits a slight response in the male, which enables him to reach a female. So the female signals that she's fertile by releasing this compound, this pheromone, and the male flies upstream eventually and reaches the female. So we have here one well-identified compound that elicits a very stereotypical response. And there's no information here about the identity of the female, just the fact that there's a female, she's fertile, and the male moth flies to her direction. So this is a classic example that warrants the use of the term pheromone. And in mammals, we don't have such, characterized examples, but definitely chemical communication is important too. And here are a few examples, there are many examples, but just a few to show you the kind of solutions or approaches that animals took to advertising things about themselves using chemical cues. So this is a maro, which is a type of a large rodent, that in this case the male is peeing on the female. It could be also on another male to signal whatever he wants to signal about himself, that he's dominant, that he's there, that maybe he's attractive. So that's one way, very active way of advertising one's presence. There's also an example of these antelopes, which mark their territory by depositing some scent that they emit from their orbital scent glands. And here's an example of using a specialized gland that secretes, that produces some compound that is used by other members of the species for getting information. For example, information that a certain individual was at a certain place at some point in time. And here's another elaborate example of a wing sac of a bat. So certain bats, which are called wing sac bats, have males, have the sex on the sac. This is the opening to the sac on the wings. And the sac, they produce a cocktail of saliva and also some, could be urine and feces and other secretions that they mix together, and together they form some signature of that male and provide information presumably about his physiological status. And what you see here is the male wafting the orders from molecules from this sac onto a female. So that's another form of advertising something about an individual. And we all know as humans, again, this is not an example of a pheromone, but we all know as humans that scent is important to us, and we also, even though we may not buy these pheromones that you saw in the previous slide, many of us do use some form of scents which make us presumably smell better to others and
say something nice about us. So mammals also, not just mammals, but also mammals, which are our family, are using chemical signals to give information that's relevant in social context. And just because I mentioned the term pheromones, I'd like to give you a brief overview of the different types of semiochemicals or chemical signals which are used for communication. And the general category is semiochemicals, which just means chemicals that provide signals or information about each other. So they provide information. So one broad category are those that act within a species. Another one is those that act between animals of different species. And the example that we saw is the example of the pheromone. So again, just to remind you or to reiterate, in this case, there's a general meaning. The pheromone says something, induces some behavior, but there's no information about the individual that gave that cue. So that was the classic example of the moth that I showed you. And again, there's a division here into two kinds of behavior. Two kinds of responses to the pheromone. One of them is a releaser response or releaser effect. And that means that the pheromone induces some type of behavior. And this is what we saw in the case of the moth. What was the behavior in this case? The fly towards the female. Another type or class of effects are called primer effects. And in this case, there is no immediately overt behavior that can be observed, but there's some physiological or hormonal change in an organism that changes something about the physiology. We'll meet such an example soon. This is the example that I will tell you about, actually the example of the Bruce effect, in which there's a hormonal change in a female mouse in response to a male mouse stimulus. This is not to say that a single compound can be either primer or releaser. It can induce both types of effects. They're not mutually exclusive, but in some cases one can distinguish one type of effect from the other. And another class another classification that people have become more popular recently is to talk about signature mixtures. And signature mixes or mixtures are unique to a given individual, and they provide information about individuality. So one example here is shown with sheep, in which the ewe recognizes the odors of the lamb when she is born. And the specific mix of odorants that's unique to that individual is remembered and used to identify. And this is not a pheromone, this is a signature mix. And we can also talk about the chemicals that act among individuals from different species. And definitions here are technical. So allomone refers to a chemical that gives a benefit to the signaler. Can you think of what an example of something that could be an allomone? But with the moth, it's within, it's the same species. Now we're talking about different species. So if you are some animal and you want what? Right, if you're, for example, a predator and you want to lure some other animal, here's an example of the spider. It's called the boa spider. And this spider, what it does, it's a female spider, that actually what she does is she makes a ball, actually, a sticky ball. That's why it's called the boa spider. And she also makes an odorant. And what kind of odorant would she make to attract a male moth? Something very similar to the moth pheromone that we saw before. And so the female spider does that. She cheats the male moth. The male moth, if she's lucky, comes to her direction. She throws this ball and catches them. This ball is sticky, and then she eats it. So that's a classic example of an allomone, something that's beneficial to whoever gave the signal. Pheromone is the opposite. It gives a benefit to the receiver. So can you think of an example that would be good for the receiver? It's not too hard for somebody. Right. On the other side, if you don't want, for example, to identify the predator, here it can work in many ways. In this example, we have a tick, and what this tick knows to do is actually recognize the odors of the deer on these twigs that I showed you before. And whenever these ticks assemble in these regions where the antelope stumble, and then they use this signal to pick up the locations of the deer. But again, there are many examples where you want to where you benefit by receiving some signal. For example, if you're a predator that wants a pre- if you're
And then there are also some cases of compounds that seem to benefit both the signaler and the one who receives the signal. And there's an example here between Kinimot. No, not lice. The name now evades me. But lice is Kinim. Ants and these Kinimot. I don't think it's mites, no.
Ask your Google.
Ask Google. And meanwhile, I'll just say that there's an example here of an interaction that's beneficial to both of them. These are aphids, so yeah, these are aphids, so no need. It's not the translation of Kinimot, but aphids and the ants seems to be beneficial for both of them, even though there's some dispute whether really the aphids benefit as much as once was thought. But this is just a general framework to show you the different types of signals that there are. Is it possible to have some airflow in this room? No? Or maybe open the window or something? What kind of support do we have for the idea that it really is specialized for innate responses? So one of them is, and I will show you some of these in more detail, is that sensory stimulation is confined to arousing situations. It's not sampling information all of the time. There's a smaller repertoire of receptors, right? You learned about the olfactory receptors. There are also the vomeronasal receptors, which are a different class of receptors, and it's a smaller variety of receptors, about 300 in mice. So it's a smaller number, and that suggests that maybe they are a dedicated class of receptors for a smaller set of stimuli. And this is something that I also mentioned, there's a more direct connectivity with amygdala and hypothalamic circuits, and hypothalamus, you probably know, is associated with many innate behaviors, homeostatic functions, and that also implicates this system and this type of behavior. And then there are lesion studies in which damage was done to the system, and that affected some of those behaviors, some innate behaviors. I'll show you one example of those. And actually, you're talking, it's not a lesion study that you're discussing today. That's something different. And then there's also functional evidence, for example, by measuring responses of neurons in the vomeronasal system. Okay? The article that you're describing today also supports the idea that the vomeronasal system is associated with innate behaviors. So let me now tell you a bit more about the system. So in mice, the sensory neurons are located in a very unique organ that's called the VNO, for vomeronasal organ. And so you don't know anything about this, right? You never learned about it. So here you can see a rodent's head, and we see a section through it, and this tube right here is one VNO, one vomeronasal organ. And there are two of those, one on each side of the nasal septum. So now if we make a coronal section, we cut the head like this, and we look at the floor of the nasal cavity, this is what we'll see. Okay, so this is the floor of the nasal cavity, this is the midline, and you see the two parts of this tube that you see it here. Okay, coronal section. And there are two important things to note in this structure. One of them is the red thing, which is a blood vessel, which can expand or constrict. And another one is this moon-shaped thing, which is called the lumen, shown in yellow. And this thing contains, this region contains the sensory neurons. So in order for any stimulus to elicit a response, it has to reach inside this lumen. And this lumen, the yellow thing, is the whole VNO can be thought of as a blind end of tube. So it has one opening at the front into the nasal cavity, and it's closed at the other end of it. Okay, so it's just like a closed tube. And it's also important to say that the whole thing is encased in a rigid bone, a rigid capsule. So the whole structure has a fixed size. So now what happens, for example, if the blood vessel dilates? What will happen to the lumen? Which is, it will constrict, shrink, right? And if the
constricts then the lumen, because there's negative pressure within the rigid bony capsule, the lumen will try to dilate, and because there's one opening in the nasal cavity, if there's anything there, it might suck that thing inside, and then where will the stimuli reach? The inside of the venous, the sensory neurons, which are located on the lumen. And this function of the lumen of the venous shown here, we can think of it as a pump actually. It's called the vomeronasal pump, because it actually pumps stimuli into the sensory epithelium of the organ. And it pumps them in, and then they are expelled out. There's not a general accumulation of stimuli, but there's just this repetitive pumping action that can introduce one stimulus and then take it, put it out, expel it, and then sample another one. No, it's not locked to the sniffing. And in fact, it doesn't have to happen all the time. So there are states when the VNO is not active, and then there are states of arousal when it is active. And what we believe is going on, we know this for some species to be true. We don't know if it's always the case, but this is what I just said, that pumping is active and sporadic, and it occurs probably during states of arousal, some kind of social arousal, but also could be some kind of a maybe fear arousal, aggressive arousal, and it's under sympathetic control. So the sympathetic nervous system controls this organ by controlling the blood vessel inside the VNO. So by controlling the constriction or dilation of the vessel, it also controls the state of the lumen, and hence also the suction. Pumping action. And another thing that I wanted to mention, because I believe you talked about this in the male olfactory system, and also because it has some computational aspect, is that there is a different. So sorry, I'm jumping. That was the VNO. That's sensory organ. Here we have cell bodies of these neurons, and where do they send their axons to? To the right, to the accessory olfactory bulb. And so here you see. This is an expanded region. Do you know that specific diagram? Have you seen it? So we see here the main olfactory bulb, and we see here the main olfactory epithelium. We see here the different glomeruli. And what is the relationship between cells, olfactory receptor neurons, and individual glomeruli? One to one. So, right, we're giving glomerular samples or collect information from one type of receptor. And then what happens at the next stage, at the microcell stage? How many glomeruli are sampled by each microcell? What? No, you're answering the question of how many microcells are per glomerulus. But one microcell, from how many different glomeruli does it sample information? One, right. One, and this is different than the accessory olfactory bulb. There's several differences, but the most obvious one is that a given microcell can sample information from different types of glomeruli. This is shown. You see here an example of several Golgi stained cells, with some of them. See this one, for example, here is getting information from 1, 2, 3, 4 different glomeruli, and it sometimes can reach as high as 12. So there's something different about the wiring logic of the main olfactory bulb and accessory olfactory bulb. And the truth is that we actually don't know what the functional significance of that is. One idea is that it may be good for integration, so you get a very early stage. Already form responses to specific combinations of stimuli, but it's not so simple, and it's not clear whether this is indeed the case here. But there's a very different organization already at this level. Yeah.
This is also microcells?
Yeah. So these are also called microcells. They're called microtufted cells. They're very similar. They have some differences. They're smaller. There's no clear microcell layer as in the male olfactory bulb, but in the general properties, they are similar and called tufted cells.
What about the receptors? Are they similar on some end of the main receptor?
I don't know what you mean. Similar, they're also transmembrane proteins, they're also G protein coupled receptors, but different.
Completely different.
And there are actually more than one class. There are at least three classes of receptors in the vomeronasal system. So, three families of receptors, yes. And in each of these families are also subfamilies and so on. But yeah, different receptors, presumably for different types of compounds. And okay, so that was the AOB. And here's an example of a lesion study that tells us something. something about the functions of this system. And what we see here, so there's one thing I'm not telling you about, but the signal transduction cascade, I mean it's related to the receptors, is different also between the main olfactory system and the vomeronasal system. And one thing that's unique to vomeronasal sensory neurons is that they have a channel, the TRPC2 channel, that is required for signal transduction in those neurons, but it's not required for the main olfactory system sensory neurons. So if you knock out this specific channel, what do? You disrupt You disrupt the glomerulonasal system, right? If you knock out the TRPC2, don't be shy if you think the question is too stupid. Just let me know that you're with me. So the TRPC2 channel knockout mice are mice that can use their main olfactory system, but not their glomerulonasal system. And here, this was the first experiment that did this, and we have an intact VNO, an animal with a functional VNO, and one that is not functional. The VNO is there, there's just no signal transduction. And what you see here in this experiment, it's an experiment, you have a male mouse, and you introduce a stranger, an intruder, to the cage. And what do male mice do when there is an intruder coming in? What? Depends how big they are. Usually they would attack the other mouse. depends on the intruder and the resident. But this is, so what you see here are different trials, different repeats of this experiment, and each time you see there's a tick, it's because there's an attack. There's some aggressive encounter. So here you have an intact VNO animal, and you have a castrated mouse, which doesn't elicit so much aggression. Okay, but then if you introduce a mouse that's not castrated, it induces a lot of aggression by the resident. On the other hand, when the resident is a knockout, you see there's nothing here, right? No black tick marks, which means he's not into attacking the intruder. So this gives us one indication that the VNO, VNS, VNO is important for controlling aggressive interactions. And another interesting thing that was seen in this study, and these are two different studies from about the same time which did the same thing, is that these mice, they're in many ways they function normally. So they mate normally, males, for example, mate normally with females. But the one thing that's less common for mice is they also mate very enthusiastically with other males as well. So they lose a discrimination between females and males in the context of reproduction. So again, another example of this is probably related to reproductive. I'm using the term innate very loosely here, but reproductive and innate behavior. So this is one example of the study. There are more examples, more analysis of how females behave and what happens when their VNO is knocked out, and all of them suggest that the system is involved with social interaction. I'm not saying at all that the male olfactory system is not important. Of course, we know very well that it is, but it seems that specifically the VNS has the role of the VNS is confined more to social behaviors than to general detection of odorants. And so now I want to describe one such phenomenon. This is the little cartoon that you saw in the slide a few slides back when I discussed a primer effect. And this is called the Bruce effect, or also the pregnancy block effect. Of any of you heard of this phenomena? All of you? Some of you? So this is just the original paper that describes this finding, and the finding is as follows. When you have a male and a female, and the female and they mate, and the female becomes pregnant, if she's exposed to a foreign male, not the one that she mated with, but one that's not a different one, the black one in this case, in a very high frequency of cases, she will abort. The pregnancy will not proceed. And the really nice thing about this phenomenon is that if she's exposed to the same mouse that with whom she mated, there will be no pregnancy block. So there's something about the odorants of this specific male which she learns during mating that prevents them from inducing the pregnancy block. And there's something interesting about odors of unfamiliar males which cause a pregnancy block. And there's a general scheme for what's probably going on here. And the idea is that
for the initial stages of the pregnancy, so I should say that this pregnancy block effect does not happen throughout the pregnancy, but only during the first 3 days in mice. And in these days, in this period, the placenta requires prolactin, hormone prolactin, which is released from the pituitary. And one major controlling point of prolactin are dopaminergic cells in the hypothalamus. And it's believed that there is a sequence of events starting from detection of male odorants from via the VNO to the AOB, going through the amygdala and leading to the hypothalamus, where you have these dopaminergic cells that causes the release of dopamine and therefore the suppression of prolactin and therefore the termination of the pregnancy. Okay, so this is the easy model for the Bruce effect. You have detection of male odorants, there is suppression of prolactin and blockage of the pregnancy. And something different is believed to happen following mating. And this is one thing that I will mention in one slide, one thing that we're interested in after that. So why do I talk about this phenomena? Because it's a very nice example of a sequence of events where we can study how a specific chemical can lead, or not a chemical, but a specific stimulus can lead to a specific response. And I should say, I didn't say explicitly, that it has been worked out that this is dependent on the glomerulonasal system, not the male factor system, and also that the odors of the strange male are sufficient to elicit this blockage. So it's not the actual male that needs to be there, but even the urine of a strange male is sufficient to induce the block. Yeah?
What is this pathway of the actual member formation?
So the leading theory is that it happens in the accessorial factor ball. And the leading theory says that during mating, there is a mechanical stimulation of the female cervix, and this leads to activation of neurons in the locus coeruleus, the region of the brainstem, that releases noradrenaline on many regions of the brain. And the idea is that noradrenaline that reaches the accessorial factor ball together at the same time that some of the cells are activated by the mating male would lead to suppression of the response to this male. And so the idea is that the memory is formed at this stage, that there's already some filters for that male with whom the female mated. And this is presumably mediated by granule cells. Maybe you learned about the granule cells in the male factor system? So presumably they exert stronger inhibition as a consequence of this process that makes the odors from this male, not sorry, from this male, makes the odors from this male be less effective and inducing this cascade of events. So the short answer to your question is at the AOB. Probably. Okay, and now I want to show some physiological recordings. These recordings are from the lab that Dee and I did a postdoc in North Carolina, at Duke, in the lab of Dr. Larry Katz. And what you see here is a recording from the accessory olfactory bulb of a behaving mouse. So this is not a simple thing to do, to put an electrode while an animal is awake and behaving. And you see here two animals. These are three snapshots from a longer video. And this is an anesthetized mouse, that just to make it easier to control the experiment. And these lines show you where the subject male was on this arena. And the dots just tell you that they mark the time that passed. And you can see that a lot of time was spent investigating, for example, the head and the anogenital region of this anesthetized animal, or the female in this case. And what you see is how the activity of one single, you can see very clearly the spikes in one neuron here, how they change the function of the behavior. And when you have an investigation bout, this pink line right here, which corresponds to investigation of the head region, you see a very large increase in the response and the firing rate of this neuron. You can also see an increase when there's an investigation of the rear region of this animal. So this is a demonstration that cells in the accessory olfactory bulb, presumably microcells, really are sensitive to stimuli with a social implication, right? In this case, another animal. To me, it was another animal from the same species. So to me, that was a very compelling study that brought me to studying this system. And recordings in awake animals are very hard. I mentioned this. They're hard for technical reasons. It's hard to find cells and maintain them for a long time while the animals are moving. In the case of the vomeronasal system, there's even a bigger problem when we record responses. And the problem is that we don't even know if the VNO was activated or not, right? We don't have, unlike the olfactory system where we can rely on the fact that the mouse is breathing all the time and stimuli reach the system, here we don't even know that. So if we see a lack of a response, we're not sure whether something is not sensitive, or for example, the receptors are not sensitive, or the specific microcells we're recording from is not sensitive, or maybe there's no stimulus uptake at all. So one thing that that I did in the cat lab is to develop a preparation that allows one to record responses in an anesthetized animal. And the trick here, because I told you that the system is not, the VNO is not always active, you have to make it pump, to make it active. And the trick here was to stimulate the sympathetic nerve. I told you that this controls the VNO, that was known from previous studies in other animals, and indeed it worked. And so it was possible to introduce stimuli. There's an animation here which I will go over briefly, but you can put a stimulus into the nasal cavity. Just putting it normally is not sufficient because it actually has to enter the VNO. And in order to activate the VNO, to make the lumen expand, we stimulate the nerve trunk and there's some electrical response, and then it changes the status state of the pump from constricted lumen to a more expanded one. And indeed, if you're recording from the right cell for the right stimulus, you will see an increase in firing rate of this cell, similar to what we saw in vivo. The disadvantages and advantages to an anesthetized prep, but one advantage is that you can control the stimuli much better. You can give the same stimulus again and again, and you also know exactly what it is that you're giving. Because when mice are investigating each other, as in the previous slide, it's hard to know what is actually the stimulus that elicits the response. Do they smell each other's urine or maybe saliva or some other secretion on their fur? So this is these are the motivations for developing such a system. So the next question is, what happens in the brain when we present specific stimuli using this approach? And here you see one of the very early recordings that was made. And these are raster displays, so you're familiar with those, right? So we have here two cells symbolized here. Of course, that's not their actual locations, but just to show you that these are two cells that were recorded at the same time, one in green, one in orange. And we give female urine or we give male urine. We present the different stimuli in mixed order. We don't give one set after the other. And we look at the responses of the green cell and the orange cell. And what we see is that the green cell responds to female urine, right? This is the average firing rate, averaged over all these repeats of stimulus presentation. I should say that time zero, what would be time zero, according to what I just told you?
Stimulation.
Right, exactly. Stimulation of the nerve and then the induction of the pumping. So we see an increase in firing rate to the female urine, and this neuron doesn't care about male urine. It doesn't change its response following presentation of male urine, but the orange one does, of course. That's why it's shown here. It increases its firing rate in response to male urine, but does not care much. If anything, it might be a little bit inhibited in response to the female urine.
You recorded from male.
From
male.
We recorded. Yes, this is from a male, but the answer doesn't matter, as I will show you in a few slides. Okay. Yeah. So this is something that I said before. These are recordings. It's similar to what we see in beheading mice, but here we have the advantage of knowing exactly what it is that we're stimulating. And this distinction between male and female, I'm trying to keep it to the theme of the Bruce effect that I mentioned, the pregnancy block effect. This is an important distinction. I actually didn't say it explicitly, but strange female will not, let's say, the pregnancy failure. Okay, it's only orders of a certain male that can induce a pregnancy block, pregnancy failure. So the system must be able to distinguish between males and females, and it was shown also by the previous in vivo and behaving studies, but also by this example here. But for mediating the Bruce effect,
system that also distinguished between what? Between different, not just males and females, but between different... Different, right, familiar and non-familiar, so between different individuals. And in these recordings, what we see are examples of three neurons, neuron 1, 2, 3, each occupies one row, and we have 6 different stimuli. So we have 3 female stimuli, 3 male stimuli, and they differ in the strain of the animal. So the exact strains don't matter, but the colors, black, white, and blue, indicate different strains of mice. You're familiar with the concept of strains of mice? So these are mice that are homogeneous genetically, and different strains have different features, which make people want to work with them for various reasons. And the advantage is that each given strain, all mice in a given strain are very similar to each other, so that reduces the variability, for example, in experiments that you make with them. And often people use different strains as a model for different individuals in the wild. Wild mice don't exist in different strains. There's much more genetic heterogeneity among them, but this tool enables us to study the responses to what are presumably different individuals. And you can see, for example, one neuron here that responds only to a specific combination of strain and sex. Only to a white female will this neuron respond to. And then there are neurons like this that respond to all the different combinations of each one of these 6 different stimuli. There are some neurons, a minority of them, you can see the numbers here from the sample, that respond to all stimuli from one sex, so either males or females, and they will not make a discrimination among the different individuals. And there are also neurons that don't obey some nice orders we would expect. So they may respond to some or the other stimuli, but not segregated by the sex of the animal. A large majority of these responses are, as you see by this number, are of this type. And this tells us that at least it seems that the AOB, and hence the entire mirror nasal system, has the ability to distinguish among different individuals. That would be the basis for this. And because this is the computational PhD, I just want to show you this little calculation that we did using responses of not just 3 neurons, but all the neurons that we had recorded with these stimuli and also with other stimuli. And what we did here, suppose we have 6 different, it's not complicated, but I'll explain it nevertheless. We have population of neurons, for example, 6 different neurons, and we have 3 different stimuli in this example. And the response, the population response, is described as a firing rate change across this set of neurons. Okay, so each different stimulus elicits a different pattern of response across the entire population. We're looking at several of them at the same time. And then we're calculating the similarity matrix between these different vectors that you see here, okay, the blue and the red and the green. And then based on this, we do hierarchical clustering. Are you familiar with this type of description? Okay, it just groups together. There's a sequential grouping of elements, and those that are grouped at lower in this graph are more similar to each other. So 2 and 3 correspond to stimuli that are more similar to each other. Similar in the sense of the responses that were elicited across the population of neurons. And there are many details about how to do this, but it doesn't matter so much now. All I want to show you is what happens when we do this calculation on 3 different types of stimuli. One of them is a generalized female stimulus, male stimulus, and here we have a predator stimulus. Okay? So different types of predator that were mixed. And what you can see here, as you might expect, that the 2 mouse stimuli are closer to each other than they are to the predator stimulus. So at one level we can say that the AOB, the end of the mirror system, cares about whether a stimulus comes from a predator or another conspecific, regardless of its sex. And then we can break this up further and look, as I showed you before, the 6 different male and female stimuli. And again, we see that when we do this hierarchical clustering, we segregate the male and the female stimuli together with each other. So again, stimuli from the same sex elicit more similar responses than stimuli from different sexes. So that tells us also that the parameter of gender or sex is represented in the system. And we can take it even one step further and look at different individuals. In this case, we're looking only at males, but in different individual males from the same, from a given strain, and we do this clustering, and again we see that all males from a given strain are clustered close to each other. So there's also a concept of genetic similarity that's represented at the activity of the AOD neurons. And this is what I said. The nice thing is that what we think of the ecological relationships, that is the meaning of these stimuli, are also reflected by the firing patterns of the population of neurons. And one question that time is moving quite quickly. One thing that I will not be able to, one thing that I cannot tell you a lot about because we're still doing these experiments actually, is what happens to responses of AOB neurons during following mating experiments. So this is one thing that's being tested in the lab by Michal, and what she's doing is she's measuring responses in females after they were mated with a black male or with a brown male, and what would she expect to see according to this theory? So for example, a female that's mated with a black male, what would we expect based on the theory that I just mentioned? What? So we're not measuring blocking directly, but we're measuring the strength of the responses, and we're expecting that following mating to a certain type of male, to a certain strain of male, the responses to that male will be decreased because of this procedure, because of this process that I mentioned. So this is something that we're testing and interesting in the lab, and the very small sample that we have seems to support this notion, but it's much too early. Wanted to show you some of the things that we're doing in the lab. And I actually already had a spoiler slide for this question. I asked, because I showed you responses to predator stimuli, but the question is whether there are responses in the system in the mouse system to predator stimuli, and there's a good reason to think that there should be, because mice are preferred food for many animals, foxes, wildcats and rats are some examples, and in these experiments we measured the responses to urine stimuli from predators. And this is you can buy these stimuli. There's a site that specializes, a store that specializes in producing various types of urine, mainly for pest control. It works to scare other animals with the bigger animals' pee, and the quantities that we need are really very small, so it's not a major expense to buy fox urine, for example. And then we can measure responses. And what you see here is, you already saw this before, but we have one neuron that responds to a female, one that responds to a male, and one that responds to a predator stimulus. So we have this capacity, and in fact, we can even zoom in on the different types of predator stimuli. This is a mixture of three different predators. We also find units that are specific to one type of predator and do not respond to the other. So the system also has the ability to distinguish among them. Now there's something interesting and a bit confusing in the following sense. Some of the responses, like the one I just showed you, this is the same panel, make a lot of sense. This neuron responds either to a male or a female or to a predator, not to both. But there's a significant proportion of neurons that respond to more than one type of stimulus. For example, here's one that responds to a female and to a predator. Here's one that responds to a female and to a male, or a male and a predator. All combinations are there. So if you want to make a decision whether you should mate now or you should run away, listening to just one neuron, especially to this specific neuron, in this case if you're a male, or to this specific neuron if you're a female, is going to give you ambiguous and potentially life-ending information. So, of course, we should consider the activity of more than one neuron, and the question is whether in downstream regions we find responses that are more selective to one type of stimulus versus the other. And so this leads me to the next stage, which is in our scheme, what is the next anatomical stage? Where is the neuron? What?
Amygdala.
Right, the amygdala. And the amygdala is a complex, so now we finished talking about the sensory olfactory bulb, we move on to the amygdala. I'll do it quicker now. The amygdala is a complex region. There are many sub-parts of the amygdala with different functions and connectivities and so on,
we're looking specifically at the subset of nuclei called the vomeronasal amygdala, which are those that mainly receive information from mitral cells of the AOB. And this is from the medial amygdala. The vomeronasal amygdala includes more than one region. The central one is the medial amygdala. So that's the one shown here. And the procedure for measuring responses is very much like the one I showed you before. The only difference is that the electrodes are inserted deep inside the brain to the amygdala. And then we're looking at responses. Are there any responses there at all? It wasn't clear when we first did these experiments. And the answer is that yes. So we see here same type of schematic, just same type of data, just with maybe nicer colors. One neuron that responds to predator stimulus, one that responds to male, one that responds to female, one that responds to several of them together. So just looking at it like this, it seems very similar to what we saw at the AOB. And we can ask the question that comes off the responses that I showed you, in which you saw cells that respond both to female and to predator, for example. The question is, maybe responses become more selective for one category or another at the level of the amygdala, the next stage. And so what we do in this plot, these triangle plots, each dot represents one neuron, one row in this graph, and the location of the dot tells us what was the relative magnitude of the response to each of the three different stimuli. So the red dot right here corresponds to a neuron that was responding very strongly to predator urine. That's why it's here. One that's here, the green, is responsive to female urine. And one that's at the center, what does it tell us about its selectivity? It's not selective, right? It doesn't distinguish among the different stimuli. This is, in this case, it shows us the relative normalized magnitude of the response. Now, we have to ask what happens at the level of the AOB in order to see if there's any change to the amygdala. And this is the picture from a different subset of neurons, of course, these are AOB neurons, for the same type of stimuli. And what does this tell us? Well, so the AOB is more or less selective, less selective indeed than what happens in the amygdala. And we can also quantify it by looking at the distributions, for example, of the distances of each dot from the center of the triangle. And we see that there's really a statistically significant difference. It's not a complete qualitative change. It's not that in the amygdala all the responses are unique to one category, but there seems to be some degree of making the responses more selective. And in the next 5 minutes, I'll tell you about something even more interesting that seems to happen in the amygdala. And this is the question of sexual dimorphism, which addresses the question that you asked me about whether we recorded in males or females. So this slide, these images here, are just to remind you that males and females are different. In many ways, it all begins with reproductive strategies, but it leads to changes in morphology and behavior and communication between the two, between the different sexes. And so we assume that male and female nervous systems must be different. And the question is, how do they differ? Okay, and how do they differ in a functional manner? And we asked this question in the context of the medial amygdala because it is one of the few regions in the mammalian brain, in the rodent brain, for example, that you can see on a very coarse anatomical level differences between males and females. It's a little bit bigger, not much bigger, but it's a little bit bigger. Some parts of the amygdala are bigger in males than in females. And this is now the same data that you saw before, but now we break it into female neurons recorded in females, shown in blue, neurons recorded in males, which are shown in blue, and neurons recorded in females, which are shown here in red. And what does this tell us? What does this tell us? That each sex is more selective to the other. Each sex, so the female, for example, they have many more neurons that are on the left side of the triangle, so they're more, the response is stronger to male than to female. And it's the opposite in males. And I should highlight, this is a pretty striking difference between males and difference, and we can also quantify this effect just as we did before. We can find an
index that tells us how much, and we're now ignoring the predator aspect. We're just asking whether it prefers female or male stimuli, and we see that the two distributions here are mirror images of each other, really, right? There's no question about the statistical significance of this phenomenon. So at the level of the amygdala, there is a difference between males and females, and that provides some support to the idea that it has a role in reproductive or sex-specific behaviors, right? Because otherwise, we wouldn't expect to see a difference between males and females. And now comes another question, is what is the source of these differences? Where does it begin? And one explanation could be that it's all a sensory effect, that it's already evident or as an outcome of what happens at the periphery. And here I remind you again of the silkworm moth. Once I highlighted the fact that males have very elaborate antenna, but I didn't say that females don't have them. So males have, there's already at the periphery a different sensitivity for a certain class of compounds. If this is also the case in the mirror nasal system, in the amygdala, what would we expect to see in the cursor of basketball? So, right, if it already starts at the level of the periphery, we would also expect to see the dimorphism at the level of the olfactory bulb. And the fact is that we don't. So when we break up the responses into males and females, just as we do for the amygdala, we don't see the same thing in the accessory olfactory bulb. So it seems like this sexually dimorphic response happens somewhere between the AOB and the medial amygdala. We don't know how. There could be several ideas for how this happens, but at the level of the AOB, it's not expressed yet. And in fact, one interesting thing I didn't prepare a slide to show you because we reached because of lack of time. But this difference that we observe in the amygdala takes time to develop. If you take very young animals, 3 weeks of age, you don't see this difference yet. Only when they're sexually mature do you see the full expression of this difference, which is again supports the idea that it has to do with some sexual reproductive function. And the last slide, which I promised, I have 1 minute so I can tell you about this. What we're doing now in the lab is also trying to record from the last stage of this pathway, which in this case are the dopaminergic cells. And to do this, we have the challenge of targeting these specific neurons. And what is the technique that enables us to do that? I'm sure you heard about optogenetics, right? You heard a lot about optogenetics, I'm guessing. So what we're doing, and this is just again to show what we're planning to do, or ongoing research, is using, these are not the mice that we got from you yet, these are the other mice, which also express channel rhodopsin in dopaminergic cells, in this case in hypothalamus, and we can activate them in the slides, and we can also activate them in vivo. This is not from these neurons, but this is from the dopaminergic neurons. And by activating them in vivo, what we can do is we can insert an electrode, and then we can identify those cells as dopaminergic, right? Because only they will, if they're the only ones that express channel rhodopsin, we can identify them from all the other cells. And this is very important when you're recording, from a very heterogeneous population of cells, like the ones that we're interested in right now. So the next set of experiments would also involve seeing how these cells respond to stimulation by male and female stimuli. Maybe this will give us more insight about how the pregnancy block effect is actually working and what happens when a certain stimulus is learned following me. So this is the end. Actually, it's pretty good time, 50 minutes. Yeah, that's it. Thank you. I also planned all the questions that you asked, so it will be.
Sure. I have two questions. One is your neurogenesis in the accessory olfactory bulb.
Yeah.
And the second, you showed several behaviors like female interaction, detecting enemies that involve both the main olfactory and the accessory olfactory bulb. Are there studies that try to check which one is more dominant in the amygdala response to block one of them and see which one is more dominant and whether the nuclei
So there's some
So there are studies that try to disrupt one system and then see what the other does. And there, generally, you can see all kinds of complex phenomena. For me, the take-home message from those studies on the behavior level is that both systems are important. And, definitely, if you knock out the male factory system, the animals don't function at all. And definitely, also, the male factory has a role in both types of behavior. So behaviorally, the answer is that both systems are involved. Now, about responses in the amygdala, there's somewhat of a dispute. Some people base mainly on either connectivity analysis or also an immediate early gene response, like CPOS, claim that the medial amygdala is a major site for integration, which could be. But in those studies that I showed you, we also tried to stimulate the medial amygdala with main olfactory system stimuli, just volatile stimuli to the nose, and we weren't successful. So in our hands, it seems like that region of the medial amygdala was much more selective for glomerulonasal cues. But I think it's still an open question. We also don't know that the medial amygdala is the only one controlling a certain type of behavior. So that's not the only question to ask. Maybe other amygdala regions could also play a role. So it's not known. There's some level of integration. Our data shows not so much. Other people claim there's more.
Does it have to do with their lateness? Do you believe that the labor and the nasal is more innate?
I believe so, but I cannot prove it. It's actually another line of experiment that we're doing. I think that the glomerulonasal system is less well designed to be flexible. I don't think that it's impossible to modify responses with it, but that it will be harder to do that. That's my guess. Yeah.
Actually, I have two questions.
Okay.
First one, are there other projections for the sensory olfactory bulb besides the amygdala, like cortical region?
So there is more than one amygdala region. So the three main regions that receive information are the BNST, which is also subcortical region, benducus and striatum terminalis. Not much is known about responses in this region. There is the PMCO, which is the posterior medial cortical amygdala, which is another part, and the medial amygdala. These are the three areas. There are no cortical regions that receive information directly, like not no piriform. I want to say that the answer is yes. The
So if there's a minimal, it's very hard to rule out any experience, to completely avoid any experience. But at least I can tell you that these males were not, they were housed only males, the females were housed only females, so there's no sexual experience that they gained. And yet they did develop this dimorphic response. So their cages, their female only cages or male only cages, there's no interaction until they're sexually mature. I would bet that there is an effect of experience and it will change the responses. It's another thing that hasn't been studied but is worth studying. But at least the basic division into the dimorphic division does exist, I think, also without any effect of experience.
Okay, we meet in Denmark.
אז יש לך דיספו אולי? אני אשאיר לך את המצגת כאן.
מה אתה אומר?
יש לך מצגת, יש לך דיספו, אני יכול להשאיר לך את ה...
זה גדול?
אני חושב שזה קצת גדול, כן.
יש לך את זה בקדיאת?
אני יכול עכשיו לעשות את זה ב-PDF, רגע. לא, אני את זה ב-PDF, אני יכול לשלוח לך את זה. יש לנו אפילו דרופבוקס ביחד.
יש לנו?
היה לנו פעם משהו של הקורס. אני אשים לך את זה שם. אין לי את זה פה. מה זאת אומרת? אני אעשה את זה כשאני אגיע למעבדה.
אוקיי.
או שאני אשים את זה פה ב...
לא, לא, תשלח לי את הדרופבוקס.
יש הורמונים אצל בן אדם, או לחלוטין ש... בוא נגיד שגם אצל עכברים יש כאילו משהו, מידע שהוא נתפס בצורה מודעת ובצורה לא מודעת. לאן היית משייכת פרומונים? כאילו אני מריח נקבה ומשנה לי את ההתנהגות ואני לא יודע למה, או שאני מריח נקבה ואני אומר לעצמי, אוקיי, אני צריך לשנות את ההתנהגות שלי.
אבל אני...
בגלל שאלתי על קורטקס, כי אני אומר, אם זה הולך לשחרר מגדרה, אז יכול להיות שזה רפלקסיבי, ואני אפילו לא יכול להגיד למה זה קורה.
זה הולך
לקורטקס. כן,
זה שאתה אומר, לא חייב לעבוד בצורה יחידה. לא. מה אתה שואל בעצם? אני רוצה לחשוב שבהלכה, אני רואה שכאילו, זה יהיה מוזר לכל, כמעט כל היונקים, ובעלי פוליות יהיה פרומונים של בני אדם.
גם לעכברים אין ממש פרומונים. זאת אומרת שגם לעכברים אתה לא יכול, המקרה הזה של האש הוא מאוד קיצוני, יש לך מולקולה אחת לזוהה גורמת לתגובה מאוד לזוהה. יש שטוענים שגם בעכברים, בכלל ביונקים, אין דוגמאות כאלה. אומנם
זה פחות...
יש מעט מאוד דוגמאות. אני שנייה נוסיף את הדברים שלי. אני לא יודע למה זה כל כך, זה ברור שלכות משקיעים עליהם, זה ברור שלכות יכולים לעורר או לדחות. אז השאלה הזאת היא שאין בפרומון לא יכול רק בעיניי קצת.
אז כאילו אתה אומר שפרומון וריחות רגילים כבר יש להם פחות או יותר את אותה משמעות ביונקים?
כן, אני אומר שההבחנה הזאת היא שיש אותה בצורה כל כך ברורה וחרקים, שיש להם משמעות מולדת, משהו גורם אותי להגות סיימת ונלמדת. היא יותר מטושטשת בבעלי חיים, יש הרבה יותר, סליחה, בבעלי חיים מוטבים, יש הרבה יותר משקל לתהליכים שאנחנו לומדים אותם. כן, ופחות.
אז מה בעצם ההבדל בחרקים, היית אומר, בין זה לזה?
ההבדל מאיזה בחינה? פונקציונלית או...
בהתנהגות, כאילו איך היית מבדיל בין
מולקולות
שנפלטות פה ומולקולות שנפלטות פה?
קודם כל יש באמת, כמו שראיתי שם בקרא, יש מסלולים שונים, אולי אני אגיד את זה פה קצת, אני לא... יש מסלולים שונים שמתווכים את ה... יש מסלולים שונים שמתווכים את זה, עובר דרך ערוצים שונים במוח.
אוקיי, אבל התנהגותית אפשר להבדיל בינם?
בטח, יהיה לך מאוד, לא תוכל, ממש בצורה מפורשת, אבל ההנחה היא שלא תוכל ללמד חרק להימנע מהאש, להימנע מהאש של הנקבה. אבל שלא תהיה לו גמישות, כי תמיד זה יפעיל את המסלול הספציפי הזה שגורם להתנהגות הזאת.
אז אחד הוא נעול והוא אינפרינטד ואין מה לעשות איתו, והשני זה משהו שהוא...
הוא לא אינפרינטד.
הוא אינט.
innate, כן.
כן. ואז השני זה משהו שיש לו בהתאם לניסיון ולסביבה. ו...
כן, כן.
הבנתי.
כן, כן.
ואז ואתה אומר שצריך להיות מורכבות, אז... אז זהו, אז אי אפשר לעשות הפתעה הזו דברים שהם אינט לדברים שאפשר לחסק איתם.
זה מאוד 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 קשה. הוא מאוד קשה, כי אתה צריך למנוע, בשביל לשאול שאלה על אינט, אתה צריך למנוע חשיפה לאותו ריח מ...
אז הנה, אז עם תינוקות. זו דוגמה שזה באמת הנה יקור לתינוק.
זאת דוגמה, אני עכשיו לא זוכר את כל הפרטים של הדוגמאות האלה, אבל שם יש את האפקט הזה שהתינוק מזיז את הראש שלו לכיוון הריח.
הם גם בודדו, הבנתי את המולקולה, זה אפילו לא בחלב, זה בנוזל שמופרש מהמסביב.
נכון.
היה הרצאה בטסט, פשוט שראיתי לא מזמן, וזה נזכר, פריסטרם, משהו.
פריסטרם
וייט, כן.
כן,
אז ממש, ראיתי את זה לפני כמה שבועות, בגלל זה אני זוכר.
נכון, כן, זאת הדוגמה שאני נתתי גם, כי נתתי הרצאה פופולרית לא מזמן, וזה גם, אני מכיר את זה, יש לו ספר מאוד
נחמד, פריסטרם.
ואני הייתי בטד-אקס הזה, שזה היה בבלגיה, זה טד-אקס, כאילו זה האח הקטן של הטד-אקס, כן. אז זאת הדוגמה הכי טובה שיש. ואיך שאני לא זוכר עכשיו את כל הפרטים, אבל יש המון רעש מסביב כל המחקרים של סינכרון של מחזור, ושינוי של הרומן של הפיוט של השים, וריחות של השפי, איך זה משפיע על זה. ויש גם הרבה מחלוקות, כמה הם באמת... מובהקים סטטיסטית, כמה מחקרים האלה נעשו בצורה נקייה ומדויקת. לכן אני אומר, אין מניעה עקרונית שיהיו, ולא צריך את המערכת הריח במעון הלילה, אבל העדויות הן חלשות וכזו בשר וכל דבר. יש גם עובדות של נועם סובל ומכון ויצמן, שמראה שיש ריחות של דמעות של נשים.
הנה, זהו, מסתיים.
יום.
רגע, שאלה קטנה.
כן.
title is Juvenile Mouse Pheromone Inhibited Sexual Behaviors Through the Vomeronasal System. Okay, so let's start with the goal. The goal of the paper, we have should be here is the we don't see the picture. Okay. So sorry about that. Okay, so never mind. Let's hope that it's only this picture that we don't see. But generally, we want to find we have the mouse, and when it is old enough, he will mate with another mouse. And the question is why when is still young, it doesn't mate with other mouse. Okay, and they want to find the sensory cues that enable recognition of the juvenile mouse. Okay, this is their goal. לא, זה, אבל אז לא רואים את זה. אוקיי. אוקיי. Encode information. So PCR, the same thing that we did in the metal cures. You find some candidate, and you do a qPCR for them, and you can quantify the level of their expression. You can do it in different tissues, sex, and ages. They did it for several of pheromones and their homologage. And we can see this is the result. Here we can see this is the age of the mouse, and this is the expression level of the different peptides that they tried. We can see that there are some peptides that express only in the adult mouse, some that are age independent, and some that express only in the in juvenile mouse. So of course they looked peptides expressed in the juvenile mouse, because we want to compare the behavior between juvenile and adult mouse. So their candidate was this peptide. This peptide, the ESP22, as we saw before, it expressed only the maximally expressed between 2 and 3 weeks of age. And they also did reverse transcription PCR, and we can see that this is a different tissue of the mouse. This is adult mouse, and this is juvenile mouse. And we can see that ESP22 is expressed only in the lacrimal gland. And they also found that it secreted into the tears, the juvenile tears mouse. Okay, this is clear?
Not into, from the juvenile.
From the...
How do they know it's really from the tears?
What
region?
What?
Eye? It looks like a...
Yeah. Okay, I didn't put it, but they did. Okay, so they found a good candidate to be the pheromone. And so basically we know that the ESP22 is a lacrimal peptide that is secreted from the teeth and of the juvenile mice. The next thing, okay, after we have a good candidate, the next thing that we want to do is to check the pepper, right? If it's detected by the olfactory system. So, as we saw last hour, there is the VNO, that is the sense organ, and basically its neurons are activated by the pheromones. So what they did, they did extracellular recording from the VNO neurons. They put the ESP22, and as we can see, when we put a big amount of ESP22, there is an increase in the firing rate, and the ESP and the neurons are okay, and they also took juvenile tears from juvenile mouse, and we can see that the same this neuron is activated by ESP22 are also activated by juvenile tear fluid, but they didn't stay activated by the adult tear fluid. Okay, question. So again, we saw it already in the next in the previous hour. TRPC2 is a key signaling component of the VNO. already saw when we know about it, there is a problem, there is a deficit. There is a deficit in some sex recognition in mice. So they want to see if it's also related to the juvenile adult behavior. What they did, it's a EVG. Basically, it's they recorded from the VNO neurons, from the VNO cells. It's a local field potential recording, and we can see two things: that when in a regular mouse, when we have ESP22, we have a change in the EVG, in the voltage, and it's associated, previous studies show that it's associated with the firing rate of the neurons. So when we have TRPC2 and ESP22, there is a difference in the field potential, but when we knock out the TRPC2, we don't see any change in the field potential. Okay? After that, they found the ESP22, that is the pheromone. They found that it's related to the VNO, and they want to check the downstream to the amygdala, and they want to check which of the neurons is activated in this pathway. So they did the immunohistochemistry, and you can see here the result. We can see that I don't know if you can see something, but the limit that there is more blue dots in this part and not in this part. Okay. They also check it with TRPC2 and without it, and as we can expect, only if there is a TRPC2 and ESP22, we can see that the cell in the middle amygdala are activated. Okay, so. They found this pheromone that is a juvenile chemosignal that activates the VNO, and that it is secreted from the pill, and it goes from the VNO to the medial amygdala. But the problem here is that, okay, we know the pathway, but we don't know the interaction, we don't know what is the role of this pathway. We don't know if it's related to adult juvenile and social interaction. So they did a sexual behavior experiment, sexual behavior test. They first started with TRPC2. We can see here they just took a juvenile mouse and adult mouse, and they checked the number and the frequency of mouse, and we can see here that with TRPC2 in juvenile mouse there is a small number of events, and also the time is smaller compared to the mouse without TRPC2, and we can see that in the adult mouse there isn't any change, and it's pretty much the same with and without TRPC2. So now we know that that TRPC2 it's involved in the VNO pathway. So it prevents the mating in the juvenile mouse. Okay? Question? Okay. The next thing that they did is to check the ESP22. So because this again it was the candidate to the pheromone that transferred the signal. So they took here they took a mouse that doesn't express ESP22 and a juvenile mouse that doesn't express ESP22 and they put the ESP22 and we can see that as the amount of ESP22 is bigger, the number of events of mouse events is becoming zero. So
the female expresses ESP22.
Yes.
Yes,
the female is juvenile, and they here the female doesn't express ESP22, and they want to check what if we will add ESP22 to the mouse. Okay. Yes, sometimes. Okay, so here it's without ESP22. Here it's some other protein, and here we can see that as the amount of ESP22 is bigger, the number of mice is getting to zero. Okay. The next thing that they check is in regular adult mouse. They just here is the regular adult mouse and the number of mouse, and we can see that if we put ESP22, the number of mouse is decreasing, not to zero as in the juvenile mouse, but still we see a decreasing. Okay. So. They did is to check, of course, both ESP22 and TRPC2, and we can see here again that we need here it's without ESP22, here it's without TRPC2, and we can see that only if we have both ESP22 and activated TRPC2. We see that the number of mouse is zero. Okay? So that is basically they found the ESP22 that is expressed in tears, and then the signals. and then the signal no, they it's from there they're perfect. Goes from the tier of the juvenile mouse to the VNO, then it goes to the middle amygdala, and like we see here, it inhibits the sexual behavior in the mouse. Okay, so basically it's very nice paper because they looked on all the process of the pheromone. First they try to find some pheromone. They just try a lot of pheromones and think that they think that can be the pheromones. After they check if the cell in the VNO and in the amygdala a response to the ESP22, and after it they check the whole pathway and see what happens if we deactivated some channel in the pathway. And the last thing that they did is to check the behavior of this mouse when they have or don't have ESP22 and when the pathway is clear. Okay? Question? Yes.
Didn't check if an immature male also has those protein?
If what? If an immature male? Don't have those protein?
Or do we have those ESP?
The ESP22? The immature
protein?
Ah, yeah. No, I think they checked, but I didn't. Yes, it has. It has.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gracias.